Hello, everyone, and welcome to day two of our TV show here at ICT Spring. It's very nice to see so many of you around us, and I wonder why that could be. I think, Tony, you have a large bit to do with that. I know you've just been speaking on stage, but just to tell some newcomers to this entourage around us, which is your entourage, really, a little bit more about you, NBA champion and club president of LDLC Asvel, born in Bruges in 1982, born into sport as your father was also a professional American basketball player. You initially started with PSG Racing in 1999, then in America, appeared in the NBA draft and was retained by the San Antonio Spurs. In your first match, you broke records. In 2003, you became the first French NBA champion. And then followed another NBA title in 2005, a third in 2007. Now, injury meant you had to drop out, unfortunately, for a while, although you did return in 2011 with Villeurbanne Club as Asvel. And after a defeat at the 2016 Rio Olympics, you turned to management and entrepreneurship, which brings you to ICT Spring, becoming, among other things, an investor in the Asvel French Club. So thank you so much, Tony Parker, for being with us here at ICT Spring and here in Luxembourg. Is it your first time here in Luxembourg?
Yes, first time. Yeah, first time that I'm here. First time that I came in this beautiful place. First time.
Well, I hope you have a little bit of time to explore the center of Luxembourg as well. Now, I know you've been speaking just now on stage, but to our audience who are amassing around us right now, tell us a little bit about the highlights of your career. As you reflect, you're still young, as you reflect back, what are the highlights for you that really stand out in your career?
For me, the highlight was just making my dream, basically. You know, all the championships is great. All the success with the national team is great. But it really started with a dream. I wanted to dream big, and I wanted to help my family to have a better life. And so when I look at it and when I look at the journey, I'm happy that everything that happened, because I had big dreams, but I never thought that everything like that will happen. That's impossible to think about all of that. So my life was even better than everything that I could dream of. And to be able to share that with the people I loved and my family, that was the best feeling when I look back.
Well, it must have been incredible for your father as well, who already had that sportsmanship inside him. What influence did he have on you and your tenacity to know how to train as a young child, which you must have had to train really hard to be able to get there at a young age?
I feel like I had the best of both worlds, because my dad was American, so it was great for the mental part of the game.
What, being American was great for the mental part?
Yeah, because, you know, we're always positive, and they dream big, and they think that nothing is impossible. So it was great for me as a kid, you know, to, I always knew that the mental part was the difference between good players and great players. You always had kids that they were maybe faster than me, stronger than me, taller than me. But if it was one thing that I was sure that will not be me, it was the mental part. And so between my mom, who was European and down to earth and don't take anything for granted, and my dad, it was a good happy middle. I felt like I had a good happy middle to attack, you know, being a professional athlete, because it's very demanding and you have to have a lot of discipline. And but I was like so motivated that I was ready for anything.
So then, just sticking with that for a minute, you mentioned your father's mental positivity because he's American. Do you think us Europeans need a little bit more of that then?
I don't know about Europeans, but for France, for sure. You know, France, they're really down. And that's why I always tell the kids or the academy or the people that I help with when I give an advice. I always say, like, if you have a dream and you tell your dream to somebody and he's not laughing at you, you don't dream big enough. And that's the US part of me, that I always wanted to dream big, because when I was telling my dream to people, they were laughing at me. They say, oh, you're too small, you're too skinny, you will never make it in France. And sometimes when you have confidence, they mix that like, oh, you have the big head, you know. But sometimes, you know, to make it, and especially when you want to go high, you have to have confidence, you know. And it's funny, because when I make it to the NBA, then all the people were saying, like, oh, maybe he has the big head. They say, oh, he's unbelievable because he has a great mental, you know, and he's he's got a lot of confidence. And so then suddenly it became a quality, you know. So that's why I always joke in friends that, you know, sometimes we should be like more positive.
And just thinking about the life of a sportsman, mm-hmm. we all know that it takes immense training, mm-hmm. but the lifespan of a sportsman can be quite short because of injury, which you've suffered as well. So did you ever think about a life beyond sport?
Yes. I always liked the entrepreneur life. I always prepare myself during my career. When I first arrived in the NBA, I wanted to meet Magic Johnson. You know, he was a great entrepreneur with Starbucks or TGI Fridays. He was very successful in business. And one of the advice that he gave me was like, create your network when you're playing, because everybody wants to hang out with you. Everybody wants to go to dinner with you.
You can see
but
that
when
around
you
right
retire,
now.
But when you retire, nobody is going to call you back. And so that's why I created a great network when I was playing to make sure that when I retire, the transition will be easy. And so I invested a lot in my career to make sure that after that, I didn't feel like I was dying. You know, a lot of athletes, they feel like they're dying when they retire. Me, when I retire, I was super excited because I was ready to attack my entrepreneur life.
And we're going to dig into that a little bit more. But just thinking about how you created that network, mm-hmm. not everybody has the stature or mm-hmm. the fame that you had. Mm-hmm. What advice can you give everybody here, everybody around you right now? You still have an incredible gravitas, a magnetism with what you've created yourself through your whole life. So what advice can you give people to create a network that is meaningful for them, not just anybody?
As simple as being nice. Just be nice to people. Just treat everybody the same. Doesn't matter if you're a CEO or you're here. In my company, in my group, it's very important that I treat everybody the same. Everybody has a role. Everybody can help. And so my advice will be just be nice. Just be kind to people.
And then I want to also think about the players that you now mentor and the people coming up. When you see the young people around you, what top five pieces of advice do you give them?
But just like I told you earlier, dream big and dream big. It sounds simple, but you have to dream big. And that's the advice that I give to the kids, to not put limit to themselves and to make sure that they think that they can basically do anything they want.
But do you challenge them on that? When they talk to you, do you kind of spar with them?
For me, the way I challenge them is seeing every day. If they're coming to the court every day, if they work hard every day, discipline, work ethic is stuff that you have to have if you want to make it in life.
Yeah, but you can also train the work ethic. So there's a book called Atomic Habits, for instance.
I don't know if you can like you can train to a certain extent, but for me the difference between the great ones is you have it in you. If you have it in you, then you'll make it. I don't know if you can really train that, you know?
Well, I don't know. I think you can train something, because the person who wrote Atomic Habits, he was a baseball player. He had a terrible accident, and step by step, tiny little changes in his daily life.
Over time,
all the difference. And he gives the example of the Olympic cyclists in Britain, actually, who weren't doing so well, but tiny changes amounted to big things. So it's a very interesting book, actually. But I want to now move to how you use your money that you've created through your amazing career and how you think about investing. There are investors here and there are an awful lot of companies that would love some investment as well. So how do you think about where you position your portfolio of money?
Me, the way I think, I start with my passion and what I want to do and how can I impact the society and how I can impact lives and how can I change and make a create opportunities for the young generation, because now I want to give back. And so the three areas that I invest is sports, obviously, education, and way of life, art de vivre.
You've added wine, I think, to your portfolio.
Exactly.
Very important. You've got that from your European mother, I think.
Exactly. No, for sure. I grew up in France, and so we love to eat. We love to drink nice wine. So I decided to invest on the rosé and champagne, you know, it's been like 6 months ago, something like that. And so a health drink too, that came out 2 months ago, it's called Smart Good Things. It's in every pharmacies now in France. That's my new like big project. Obviously being a dad of two kids, the 8 and 6, I pay a lot of attention to what I put in their bodies. I was very careful what I put in my body. And so that project was a good way for me to have an impact on people's life, to make sure that they stay healthy.
You obviously have a legacy that you can give back, and you now have your two young children. Mm-hmm. And when it comes to teaching them about money, what are you going to do? Because will they have the same ethic, that drive that you had?
I hope they don't waste it.
Does money change that? Because they are living in a privileged lifestyle now.
It's funny that you asked that. I always have those conversations, you know, with them, you know, because obviously they didn't grow up like me. Me and my brothers, we grew up with nothing, like nothing, teeny apartment. My kids is like totally different. So I spend a lot of time to teach them, you know, about the real life and what you have to do, you know, to make sure you can deserve, you know, all that. So I'm really tough on them and try to teach them to make sure they stay appreciative, you know, and they don't take anything for granted.
And then just moving back to how you invest, have you had a time to wander around ICT Spring?
No, I didn't have time, but I would love to go around. I love to invest in tech. You have great companies all around the world, and I'm always interested in different stuff that is happening and new technology. So I'm definitely going to spend some time and take a look.
Well, I think there's a lot of people around here right now who would love to talk to you and have a couple of minutes of your time. And I think I'm being encouraged to give that time right now by Charlotte behind you. Tony, it's been a pleasure.
Right, thank you very much.
Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.